Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beyond the Baby Blues, Anxiety and Depression During and After Pregnancy, by Rebecca Fox Starr. Narrated by Raechel Wong. Introduction. Emergency rooms 3 and 4 were connected, but separated by a thin curtain that could be opened in order to create a makeshift suite. In room 4, in a stretcher that appeared humongous, lay my son, 3 days shy of being 2 months old. He was hooked up to an IV, had an oxygen monitor taped to his tiny toe, and was receiving a constant stream of oxygen through a tube in his nose. In room 3, I lay, dizzy and disoriented, chained to an IV pole, and receiving my third bag of fluids. A nurse handed me a yellow pill, potassium. She told me that I was deficient and to swallow. "Do you feel safe?" she asked. I did not. I tugged at the arm of my sweater reflexively to make sure that the scratches on my arm were not visible. We were in a suite in the emergency room of a hospital. He and I were together, but still so far apart, as we were each confined to our beds. We were ailing. We were both being poked and tested and medicated. We both needed help. Part 1. A Happy Story. Chapter 1. First Comes Love. A Pregnant Pause and Other Crazy Tales. Once upon a time, in the suburbs of Philadelphia, I met and married the boy who grew up around the corner. And we lived. Well, we lived through many things. But I should back up. My happy story began long before I met my husband, Kenny. But in order to tell this story, I am going to start in March 2006, when I cut him off with my car. Though we had both gone away for college in 2006, Kenny and I found ourselves back home, in the town where we had grown up. We were raised in a neighborhood that was a mecca for young families. 10 streets, each named for a Revolutionary War general, surrounding General Wayne Park. I lived at 519 Mercer Road until I was 10 years old. Kenny was raised at 518 Monroe Road. We grew up one street apart. Despite our nearly 4-year age difference, we share so many of the same childhood memories. The same mailman, the same ice cream truck, the same neighbors and babysitters, the same hours spent in the park that we could see from our own bedroom window. We sat on the same merry-go-round so many times as children that it would be impossible to count. And, like every good neurotic child from the main line, we saw the same therapist. I went to cope with my beloved grandmother's death, and Kenny went during his parents' divorce. The stuff of fairy tales. Though we had attended the same school since preschool, we never became friends, nor did we connect until that early spring in 2006, when we each found ourselves back in the burbs, looking for something. Someone, really. Thanks to a brief dip in the pool of online dating, some close mutual friends, and serendipity, as it were, I became connected to a young man named Kenny Starr. When I first saw his name appear on my computer screen, it took a moment for me to place him. Kenny Starr. This kid had been a senior when I was a freshman in high school. We had taken the same bus. He had a reputation. So, within a few seconds of seeing his name on my laptop, I decided that I most certainly would not be dating him. I canceled my online dating memberships, but Kenny somehow got my screen name. Even when he sent me an incredibly kind first message, I was certain that we were just going to be friends. Though he continued to reach out to me every day, I had no expectations. Except our conversations were amazing. exciting, different, fun, familiar. We talked, moving from the computer screen to the phone. The first thing that I noticed was his beautiful voice, which I still cannot describe in words. But I think that's what first made me start to fall in love with him. In those early days, we talked about our lives and shared secrets, and the minutes turned into hours as we talked through the night and into the morning. Until one day, I had to cut our conversation short. I had an appointment. I told Kenny that I was going to the allergist. In truth, however, I was going to see my therapist, the aforementioned shared therapist. Even though we had bonded a great deal over the phone, I wasn't quite ready to tell this guy, a guy whom I'd never really met, that I was going to see a shrink. I was 20 years old and not quite comfortable talking about mental health issues, which, at the time for me, were limited to a mild case of anxiety and a few irrational fears thrown in, before a first date. And so I told him that we would talk after my allergy appointment, and I went to tell my therapist all about this new, exciting guy. After my appointment, anxious to go home and finish my conversation with my crush, I pulled out of the therapist's long driveway and cut off a black Volkswagen with my black Toyota. I looked up, and though it happened so quickly before we each sped away, I saw the face of my crush behind the wheel. Kenny Starr. I had cut off Kenny Starr while pulling out of the driveway to my therapist's office. Horror. I got a text message within a minute. "Was that you in the black Camry?" he asked. And so I did the noble, honest admiral thing. I lied through my teeth. "Oh, really? That was you? That's so funny. Yeah, so after the allergist, I took the long way home and was turning around in a random driveway in Gladwin. So funny." "It is funny," he said earnestly and innocently. "You actually turned around in the driveway of the shrink I used to see when my parents were separating." Bless his heart. A day later, I came clean. Later that week, we had our first real date, to which he brought me Rice Krispies treats, instead of the traditional flowers. Smart man. And after he dropped me off that night, I called my mom. "You are going to marry him," she said. And she was right. From the very beginning, we fit together like two puzzle pieces with an instant level of comfort and support that typically comes with age and time. He said the right things, not because he had game, he did not, but because he's a good human being, the best. He always made me feel wanted and seen and loved. In those very early days, he would surprise me at my apartment door after a long day apart, just so we could give each other a kiss goodnight. He always answered my calls and messages, and when I asked him if he wanted to make plans, he never played games. He invited me into his world with open arms and an even more open heart. And it should be noted that he kept my pantry stocked with an endless supply of Rice Krispies treats. The good fancy kind, too. A few months later, Kenny and I spent our summer together down at the Jersey Shore. In those days, we would sit on the beach for hours on end, watching as families retreated, lugging their umbrellas, coolers, and kids into minivans, parked tightly on our beach block street. One summer evening, we stayed out later than usual, until we were the only people left on the beach. We sat in beach chairs, tracing our feet in the warm sand, watching the sun retreat into the horizon. The first weekend we spent down the shore, as they say in the glorious Philadelphia suburbs, together was also the first weekend that my husband met my extended family. He was coming into my life at a difficult time for all of us, as we were dealing with the horrible and unexpected illness that was afflicting my uncle. My dad's younger brother, Andy, was battling stage 4 metastatic melanoma, It had come out of nowhere. Uncle Andy was 43. We were all a little off that summer, but Kenny managed to stay strong for me, offering love and support, even though he was wading through somewhat tumultuous and definitely new oceans. So many things became very real that weekend. I remember silently daydreaming about our future, something that seemed so far away, yet so very real. And I had something very important to tell him. Our baby's name. We were not engaged. I was not pregnant. Our daughter would not be born for many more years. But that day, I knew her name, and I had to get his approval. I remember how nervous I was, drawing graffiti in the sand with my fingers, hoping with all of my might that he would say yes to me. Because I was not just asking this man, my new boyfriend, to agree to a future name for our future baby. I was really asking him for a future. To have babies with me. To agree to a family. And to a forever. That weekend, my husband met and got to bond with the member of my family who would not see the following summer. My Uncle Andy would not be able to dance with us at our wedding or hold up our huppa. He did not get to swing me around his massive tattooed arm in a rowdy hora. He wouldn't be there when our children were born. Although, if I am being totally honest, I believe that he was actually there for all these moments. He would, however, be the one whom my husband would call just a few months later to ask his permission, along with my dad's, for my hand in marriage. And he would be the person for whom our daughter is named. The same name that I had told my husband on the beach that day, during our first summer. Annabelle. So on that day, years ago, sitting in the sand, as the sun began to fade, Kenny became a member of our family. And as my uncle's life had begun to fade, this family morphed and shifted, undulating like the ocean before us. That summer, Kenny agreed to so much more than a baby name. He would be there for me and for all of us, in good times and in bad, in health and through devastating sickness. He agreed to it all that day. He said yes to our tomorrow, for as long as we both should live. In 2008, we got married, went on a honeymoon, and bought a house. And after years of being together, we would still stay up until all hours of the night, talking and laughing, just like in our early phone conversations of years past. I would often go to bed with my stomach hurting because I had been belly laughing so hard. Kenny has always known how to make me laugh. In 2009, after our first year of marriage, I got the baby bug, and I got it bad. I was ready to get pregnant and to get on it. On it. After much discussion and perhaps a bit of nagging, Kenny agreed, pulling me aside during our family's Thanksgiving dinner.
Maybe next year at Thanksgiving, we can say we have something else to be thankful for.
I think that would be very cool, he said. And just like that, we were trying. And then, when I didn't get pregnant the very first month, we went from trying to conceive, or as it was often called, TTC, a distinction that anyone dealing with fertility issues, big or small, short-term or permanent, knows well. Some people would call my approach to getting pregnant impatient. I am going to go with impassioned. I had always dreamed of becoming a mother, and once we started to try, it could not happen soon enough. After the first few months without success, I started to scour message boards, look for signs of ovulation, and cry. I was the first of my friends to get married and to try to have a baby. And so, I had no one in whom to confide who could actually relate. My best friends were fantastic and supportive, but they had no idea what the hell I was talking about when I asked them about egg white cervical mucus and if they had ever noticed it. It took 8 months, dozens of pee tests, many ultrasounds, a few visits to a specialist who said that I had no fertility issues whatsoever, and a major dose of chilling the heck out. But in August 2009, I found out that I was pregnant. And not only was I pregnant, but my baby was also due the exact same day that my mom had been due with me, April 18th. If there is such a thing as normal, my pregnancy with my daughter was pretty darn statistically average. I, however, was not. I was anxious, making sure to do everything right. And so I was careful not to lift anything heavy, I took my prenatal vitamins religiously, and I avoided deli meats, nitrates, and unpasteurized cheese. Those things would be, to use the aforementioned term, normal for a pregnant woman. At 20 weeks, we had our anatomy scan, during which time an ultrasound technician shows you every part of your growing baby. Though we had originally decided to wait on finding out the sex so that it would be a surprise, we called an audible while the tech had her wand down between the baby's legs. "Well, here is her bottom," the tech told us. "There isn't anything there," said my husband. "I see three lines," I said shakily. I knew what those three lines meant. We were having a girl. For anyone who says that by finding out the sex of the baby before delivery you are missing out on a great surprise, I am here to say that in that moment, in the small hospital exam room, I felt more surprised, grateful, happy, and emotional than I could have ever imagined. Not 1 ounce of joy or wonder was taken away by finding out the sex during my scan. My husband and I hugged and cried. "We get to plan a wedding," I whispered, which is what my mom said when I was born and placed upon her chest. Finding out that our baby was a girl made things all the more exciting and all the more real, but it also increased my level of stress. She stopped being an unknown and, in my mind, was a person with a name. And so my fretfulness caused me to take things to a whole new level. One night I was mistakenly served tonic water instead of club soda. I called the doctor convinced that I had inadvertently poisoned my baby with quinine. Another time, I called the obstetrician's emergency line to make sure that the expired bottle of honest tea that I had consumed but one-third of was not going to cause irreversible damage. And then there were the Google searches. These included, but were not limited to, baby safe when 25-pound dog jumps on pregnant belly? Does the sound of a hairdryer scare a fetus in the womb? Do coffee shops ever accidentally serve caffeinated coffee posing as decaf? Needless to say, I avoided caffeine and herbs in tea and medicine. And despite my desperate attempt to have control over my pregnancy by following all of the rules, preparing for natural childbirth with hypnosis training, and being a straight-A vessel of life, I ended up with a birth experience that was nothing like I had expected. I was ready to take on labor like a champ, or so I thought, when my contractions, which I had been waiting for weeks, started to come at short, regular intervals during my 40th week of pregnancy. I went to sleep on a Wednesday night, feeling a strong, tight pulling sensation in my abdomen. Once the pain increased, I started to casually clock them. They were coming every 5 minutes. Knowing that I would be heading to the hospital the next morning to meet my daughter, I could hardly sleep. One more night to go, I thought. My dreams will really be coming true. By morning, I was experiencing the magic formula for contractions. They were 5 minutes apart, they lasted for at least 1 minute each time, and the episode continued for more than 1 hour. I had been having intense Braxton Hicks contractions for weeks and weeks, where my entire stomach would tighten up into a crazy, lopsided knot. When this would happen, I was actually happy to be having these practice contractions, because I felt like my uterus would be in good fighting shape for the big day. The real thing. And at some point, I was sure they would start to help my dilation or effacement process. And so by 8 a.m. on that Thursday morning, I had been having regular painful contractions every 5 minutes, lasting more than 1 minute each, for about 10 hours. I called the OBGYN and told him that I was in pain. He told me that he was happy to hear that. "Come on in," he said enthusiastically. This had better not be a false alarm. I refuse to be one of those false alarm people, I told my husband. "You are so in labor," my husband told me. "I can't wait to meet you," I told the baby. I put some blush on my cheeks, wrangled our dogs, and grabbed our hospital bag, and we were off to meet our baby. My husband and I made the mutual decision to have my mom with us in the delivery room. We both wanted to be able to hold her hand, if need be, and I knew she would be able to be strong, even if it got scary. She had been through it twice, and could be the motivation I needed to stick with my au naturel labor plan. Plus, my husband had previously experienced episodes during which he would be a little queasy. If he went down, I needed a backup. So we grabbed my mom, and off we went. I felt pretty good walking into the hospital and waddling, stopping every few minutes during contractions, up to labor and delivery. When the resident came in to examine me before my obstetrician arrived, we were all surprised to learn that I hadn't progressed at all from my checkup earlier in the week. However, my contractions were strong, long, and regular, so the doctor told me that this was just early labor, and that I'd be in full-blown labor in no time. My physician told me she had a good feeling. So, we waited, and waited. And 3 hours later, my contractions only intensified. My OBGYN came in to visit me. I was in tremendous pain and felt tears stinging my eyes. My doctor took one look at me and said, "You're not in real labor. I can tell by looking at your face." I was in shock, and rage. "What do you mean, not in real labor? Aren't you seeing my contractions on the monitor? Don't you see these tears?" But as the nurse told me, in real labor, I wouldn't be able to walk and talk. When that time came, I would just know. And, just as the doctor had predicted, my exam revealed that I had not progressed at all in those 3 hours. I was 1 centimeter dilated and 50% effaced. He assuaged my disappointment by telling me not to worry, that he would most definitely be seeing me in 24 to 48 hours for the real deal. And they sent me home. When you are 40 weeks pregnant, have been on bed rest for 6 weeks, did I mention that I had to go on bed rest as I was experiencing some vertigo that made me a fall risk? Because that happened. And are swollen, miserable, and desperately impatient and unreasonably anxious, having to waddle out of the hospital without a baby in your arms is not a fun thing. Plus, I was a little embarrassed. Yes, all signs had pointed to labor, and yes, the doctor himself had told me to come in. And yes, the doctors who had examined me in labor and delivery were sure that I was in labor. But it was not a good feeling to add to the other not good feelings happening south of the border. The next morning came and went. I bounced on my big silver gym ball. I pressed all of the acupressure points that I knew how to find. I ate approximately 9 whole pineapples. I could still walk and could still talk. And I told myself that I would not be going back into labor and delivery until it was really, truly beyond a shadow of a doubt, time to give birth. I would hold out as long as possible, so that by the time I arrived, all that I would have to do was push. Maybe once or twice. But in reality, at the time, I was in agony. Not only had I not slept in 2 nights, but I was also having strong contractions every few minutes. And worse than that, I was in a horrible state of unknowing. In order to distract me, my mom took me out on a shopping trip. And after a day of walking and contracting, I sat down on my bed, put my feet up, and looked at the clock. It was 4 o'clock on Friday afternoon. I stretched my legs and leaned my head back. And then, suddenly, there was water. There was no big gush of water, but I felt water pour out from me. And I had not peed myself. This was not the buckets that had been described by friends, my doctor, and my labor class when people spoke of the water breaking. It was nothing like what they show in the movies. But I knew that it was something. And though it was a small amount, it continued. Once again, I called the special emergency after-hours line for my obstetrician's office and spoke to the nurse. Your water broke. Your membranes are ruptured. We need to be very careful now. Come on in and hurry. Finally, the time had come. I could scarcely believe that it was actually happening. I had heard that a water breaking was something that happened to women in only about 10% of pregnancies. So I had doubted strongly that I would ever find myself in that select group. But sure enough, water everywhere. Back to the hospital I went. Once again, we drove to my parents' house. Once again, we dropped off my dogs. Once again, I reminded my dad to give them tons of extra love and kisses. And once again, I walked. Yes, I could still walk, but this time I had a broken water. Into the hospital, rode the excruciatingly long elevator ride up to the labor and delivery unit, and planted myself on the hospital bed. I was in for the long haul. Once again, a resident came in to do my examination. And once again, she looked at me sheepishly and told me that I would not like what she had to say. According to my internal examination, I was 1 centimeter dilated and 50% effaced. No. That is actually not possible. I'm sorry, but you must be mistaken. Or crazy. You're crazy. I must have progressed since yesterday. I have been contracting every 3 minutes for 48 hours. My water broke. I cannot say with full confidence and a clear memory that this was my exact quote, but I know that I said some, if not a variation, of all those things. Maybe more. And there were tears. I may even have thrown some things. Expletives at the very least. I think the young doctor shrugged apathetically, and so, once again, they had me wait while running tests to determine what was going on with my stubborn cervix. At one point, my blood pressure went up, which was because I was upset and scared. And that's what happens when people are in distress. I asked the resident, I know that my blood pressure just got high, but am I okay? She just looked at me and shook her head slowly from side to side. Predictably, I was not, in fact, okay. I waited more, they tested more, and finally, the resident came back in to tell me that no, my water had not, in fact, broken. I was incredulous. There had been water. And although not in copious amounts, there was enough. I had felt it pour out of me, out of nowhere. I had felt it continue to leak. And because we are getting truly intimate here, I will share that it was clear and it happened several times. The physician could not explain it. She just said that my water had not broken and that I had not dilated or effaced anymore. I was sent home again. By that point, I stormed and stomped, still waddling, out of the hospital, determined that my baby would just live in me forever, growing up in my womb, graduating from high school and then college, from inside my bulging belly. It would never end. I went to bed that Friday night feeling hopeless. I woke up the next day, a nice Saturday morning, feeling desperate, but also a little concerned. My baby was being a little quiet. It's not that I wasn't feeling her move at all, I was. Just not as much, and not the same way. I was a little freaked out, but I recalled an old wives' tale out there that claims that a baby slows down and grows quiet the day before a woman goes into labor. I kept this kernel in the back of my mind, but couldn't quell the butterflies that were flying around the quieter baby in my belly. I spent the day walking around, bouncing, fretting, and whining, and I went for a pedicure. At the nail salon, I happened to be seated next to a nice young doctor who worked at the hospital where I would be delivering. She was a general practitioner, not an OBGYN, but that did not stop me from peppering her with anxious questions. I asked her if it was normal that my baby was being significantly more quiet. I kept using the word quiet because I could not think of a more appropriate or descriptive word to describe what I was feeling. Or, I should say, what I was not feeling. The kind doctor told me that I should be feeling the baby moving throughout the day, and that if I hadn't felt much in a few hours, I should be sure to call the doctor's office, the emergency line. We exchanged smiles, and I got her business card and held on to it, along with the worry that was in my heart. Something just didn't feel right. There is a very common belief that a mother has some sort of inexplicable, possibly divine, intuition. Well, this was it. It was noon, and I decided to take another walk, this time around an outdoor shopping area. I could barely move by this point in the day, but I was determined to stay on my feet, in the hopes that gravity would work its magic. My husband and I strolled, but even as I walked and contracted, I couldn't push away the anxious feeling that was rising inside of me. I was feeling my baby move occasionally, but it was just different. I could write the whole story now about the next thing that happened that day, the thing that started an avalanche of events that are so unbelievable that I would absolutely be incredulous had I not lived through this myself. If you recall, I used to see a therapist for mild anxiety and some fears, which included separation anxiety. My phobias were my mind's way of preparing me for the worst, loss. So when I was hobbling around the shopping pavilion and saw my phone light up with my mom's name, I answered, expecting to complain to her about my abject agony, but she cut me off.
"Bex, something happened. There's been an accident," she said. And then my world stopped. I, like my baby, went silent. The news was this. My mom's sister, my dear aunt, had been trying to park her large SUV in an underground garage in downtown Philadelphia, but it would not fit without moving a traffic cone. When she got out to move the cone to make room for her truck, the vehicle, not properly placed in the park position, ran over her. She was alive, but one side of her small body had been completely crushed. This news distracted me. I do not know how I got home from the shopping center that afternoon, but the next thing I remember was choking down a dinner of a cheeseburger smothered with hot peppers. There is so much more to this part of the birth story, but the most important part happened next, when I finally listened to my mommy gut
despite all of the false alarms and familial distractions. My husband and I had gotten home and into our bed, and my mind started to churn in overdrive. The baby was still quiet. Something was going on. I decided that I had to call the emergency on-call doctor's line yet again, with my tail between my legs and a baby nestled in my uterus, for whom I cared and worried deeply. I told the on-call doctor that the baby was quieter. She told me reassuringly that she was probably fine, but if I was really worried, I could come in. I detected the slightest hint of annoyance in her voice, as I was bothering her at 9 on a Saturday night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.